Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. It is really good to see you all gathered together in the Great Hall, the first time since the second week in September. Those at the front of the hall will not be so familiar with this important part of our daily, of our weekly school life. And this is the part where you feel connected to the school community. And it's like, for this reason, that I'm really pleased to see you back. I'd also like to give a special thanks to Mr. Spooner this morning, who, in recognition of International Women's Day, the theme for today's assembly, has chosen music composed by women. Before we begin, I'd like to hand over to James, who will lead us with our thought for the day.
At its core, International Women's Day is an expression of empathy and compassion. In the current climate, these values are more important than ever. These traits are also being put to the test as the invasion of Ukraine and the broader humanitarian crisis has halted the usual celebrations. We must remember all those people being displaced from today's founding nations, and let us employ them again by holding the victims of this war in our thoughts, or perhaps by supporting the broader humanitarian efforts. Thank you, or rather, děkuji.
And thank you very much, Jay. So today is International Women's Day, and some of you in the hall might be thinking, what's this got to do with me? And I would argue, everything. I think to help you understand your role in International Women's Day, I'd like to start just by sort of like telling you a story or getting you to picture a scene. It's 2017, and Andy Murray, the international tennis player, who currently at that time ranked number one, has just been defeated in the Wimbledon semi-final by American player Sam Querrey. Murray sat in the post-match conference with a bank of microphones in front of him. A reporter wants to know what this might mean for US tennis. Andy, Sam is the first US player to reach a major semi-final since 2009. How would you describe male player? Says Andy under his breath. I beg your pardon? Male player, right? Yes, male player, that's for sure. The nervous chuckling and mutters of acknowledgement you can hear in the room are incredibly powerful. The thing is, no one in that room should have been surprised to hear this casual sexism where women's achievements are somehow deemed less than men's be called out by Andy Murray. Just a year earlier, when interviewed by John Inverdale, where he was asked how he felt about being the first player to win a second Olympic gold tennis medal, he once again correctly points out that Serena and Venus Williams have, and I quoted, won about four each. Andy Murray was also the first male tennis player to employ a female coach. And it was this that opened his eyes to what it is to be a woman in sport. It opened his eyes to the sexism that was rife within tennis, as both he and most severely his coach experienced comments not only from the public, but from his fellow players. And this is something that we still see every day. Whilst we'll happily support women in sport, it's true that men's achievements are often given a higher status or priority. Laura Kenny, one of the greatest cyclists of all time, is still often referred to as simply being the wife of Jason Kenny, another cyclist. Another classic example is when Katarina Johnson-Thompson won European gold, a major achievement, but her story was only 22 on the BBC website. A higher priority given to male achievement, and even a golfer whose only achievement that day was simply to have a tantrum and throw his club into a lake. Once again, we should not be surprised that this casual sexism where women's achievements are not given the same priority as men's was called out by Andy Murray. And this International Women's Day, Andy Murray is a great role model for us all about how we can all make a difference for equality. And it's about the power of male allies. And you'll have heard this concept before as we celebrated LGBTQ Awareness Month, the importance of being an ally. And before we move on, I do think it's important to recognise that women are not the only marginalised gender. Trans and non-binary people are also marginalised in society. But for today, we're going to focus on men and women. And on that note, I'd like to hand over to Miss Roddy, who will lead the second part of this assembly.
This is the first time that as Bolton School Boys Division, we have done an extended whole school assembly on International Women's Day. In Girls Day, it's been a big event for a number of years, and it's time for us to start making it a big event as well. Discussions around gender equality focus, and rightfully so, on the situation of women and girls. However, to make meaningful progress, men and boys must be positively engaged in the debate. This, in turn, will help to further the equality agenda for women and girls. This is what must guide us as a school moving forward, as we consider how male allies can impact change and speed up progress. So why International Women's Day at all? Last year, many of you took part in the Omne Statii lessons, examining the exclusion of women from recorded history and the challenges faced by men and women. But wasn't that all in the past? Well, it turns out it wasn't. When fewer large companies are run by women than by men named John, we know we've got a problem. This absolutely is not to blame you. As young people, you are yet to impact on this kind of decision making. But as bright, educated young people who will one day grow up to lead companies, teams, and schools, we want to help you to recognise the importance of gender equality and feel empowered to help further it. I would not be so presumptuous as to stand in front of you today and tell you what you ought to believe in. As intelligent young people, you must study the facts and make your own decisions. But as your teacher and as a feminist, I have a duty to teach you to be critical thinkers, to assess a situation and to judge right from wrong. In an assembly about gender equality, the word feminism, unspoken until now, is the elephant in the room. Mr. Ford and I thought it only right to introduce the term at some point today. So what is feminism, and what does it have to do with us as a school community? In many ways, it's a loaded term. Everyone sat in this hall today will have an opinion about what it means, myself included. If you look in the dictionary, feminism is the belief that women should be allowed the same rights, power, opportunities as men, and be treated in the same way, or the set of activities intended to achieve this. And in practice, I thought it would be helpful here to share my own story of feminism and the stories of some other teachers in the school. As a teenager, I defined myself as a feminist without really understanding what was packed into that term. It was simply the belief that men and women should be equal. I remember feeling somewhat indignant when friends of the same age said that they weren't feminists, but I wasn't yet educated to understand why not, or to present any reasoning as to why they should be. Today, being a feminist means different things to me and to everyone who defines themselves as such. For me, it means progress. For example, should I choose to get married, I can continue to work. For my great-grandmother, that was not the case. She was the rebel of the family, and she posted her marriage bans, a piece of paper saying that the wedding was taking place, in a village miles away from her hometown. Had people known that she was married, she would have had to give up work. At the time, women in certain professions had to stop working when they married. I guess in some senses, my grandmother's small act of rebellion was a feminist act. Although I wonder if she would have defined herself as such, given that the term was not in common usage at the time. It's certainly true to say that well-behaved women rarely make history, as Lily's rule breaking has gone down in our family history. The progress that we have made as a society has afforded me opportunities that my great-grandmother would barely have dreamt of. I have the opportunity to do things that scare me, like standing up here today and giving this assembly. For Mr. Ford, being a feminist means that he actively looks to promote equality because he does not want to live in an unjust world. He believes that women should have the same opportunities as men, and he will actively support them with this. Recently, he was approached by a national newspaper and a national conference to talk on topics that there are actually women much better qualified to talk on. Instead of taking the job and taking the money, he encouraged the newspaper and the conference organisers to approach the people, the women, best qualified for the job. Mrs. Ryder shared her own thoughts on being a feminist, and I want to share those with you today. Growing up as the youngest of five, I have two older sisters and two older brothers. I have four nieces and great nieces, and 16 nephews and great nephews. So lots of men and boys in my family, and I love them all dearly. The women in my family are as strong as the men. So growing up, I observed and decided that I wanted to have both a career and a family life. I also had female role models on TV, and I followed their careers. I would never have used the word feminist in association with my own identity. As for many at the time, it was perceived negatively as a way of upsetting the balance, although I could see that things weren't quite balanced. So, in my own quiet way, I set about forging my career and raising my family. Why should you care? Well, for me, it's the word equality that's key. Why should being born a woman or a man make any difference? If we consider it at the most basic of levels, I want the very best people in roles, regardless of their gender. Consider the role models you have at home and at school. Look for positive and inspiring characteristics that have nothing to do with a biased opinion. We should all take inspiration from happy people, kind people, hard workers, regardless of whether they're a woman or a man. As leaders of the future, ensure that you employ only the very best. Only this sort of humility and unselfishness will ensure a most productive, kind, and happy workplace. And we all want that, don't we? Mr. O'Toole also defines himself as a feminist, and he wanted to share this today. I think the biggest misconception among boys, and I was probably guilty of this as a teenager, is thinking that feminism is an attack on men and on masculinity. But I have come to realise that the idea that women's rights are gained at the expense of men's is actually the opposite of the truth. Men benefit greatly from gender equality, and because of that, it is our job to help dismantle that privilege and ensure a far greater improvement of the position and status of women in society. We should also consider the wide-ranging evidence that men too benefit from living in more gender-equal societies. So for me, feminism is not just a thing for women to worry about. Instead, it is a movement that benefits us all. For us as a school community, feminism means hope. It means that we can deliver the same messages in the girls' and the boys' divisions. Both girls and boys can aspire to become doctors, nurses, lawyers, teachers, scientists. Both girls and boys can show emotional vulnerability and see this as a sign of strength. Because, as Mr. O'Toole said, gender inequality affects men as well as women. In our own context as a boys' school, it's vital that we recognise this. Boys don't cry. Be a man. How many times do we hear this kind of thing? The pressure on men to be strong, to always be in control, to take the lead in every situation, is immense. Many of you will have heard the phrase toxic masculinity, The idea that adhering to traditional male gender roles stigmatises men and limits the emotions that they can freely display in society. We all know that this has an enormous knock-on effect on mental health. Here we have it. Achieving gender equality is not a zero-sum game. Women gaining more rights, freedoms, leadership positions is not about taking those away from men. It's about redressing the balance. Women make up half the world's population. It stands to reason that they should also make up 50% of CEOs, board members, head teachers, world leaders. It's not that we don't want any CEOs called John, we just want some women as well. This, of course, links to diversity more widely. Leaders should represent our society as a whole. Women, men, people of different races and ethnicities, members of the LGBTQ plus community, people with disabilities, people from different social backgrounds. This isn't a simple case of ticking the box, of doing the so-called right thing for the sake of it. Countries with higher levels of gender equality have a higher GDP. Studies by Harvard have shown that companies with more diverse boards are up to 15% more profitable. Most importantly, evidence proves that women and men who live in societies and relationships with a greater level of gender equality are happier. We all stand to gain. Sometimes people talk about giving women a seat at the table. But it's not just about permitting women to sit there. It's about listening and understanding why they are angry and how we can help. As teachers, our hope is that you will become lifelong learners. That's what being a male ally is all about. That's what being a feminist is all about. It's all about listening and learning. Learning about history, about politics, about how to feel uncomfortable. We all have privilege, albeit in different ways. The most interesting thing about privilege is that we don't actually know it's there until it's gone. It's how we use it that matters. And so we have to have humility and be prepared to feel uncomfortable when talking about it. After all, it's only if we spot our privilege and our bias, and then we actively correct for them, that things can begin to change. Imagine you're climbing up a ladder towards the top of a tall building. It's hard work, steep, tiring. You reach the top and you realize that there are people down below you, also trying to start climbing the ladder. You have a choice. Do you pull the ladder up and claim victory for yourself? Or do you cheer on the people below? That's what being an ally is all about. We don't want to pull the ladder up from behind us. We want those following in our footsteps to find it that little bit easier than we did. I've tried to do this a lot over the past few years. My own understanding of feminism has developed, and it is now intersectional. This means that I'm working to educate myself, to recognise the ways that people's social identities can overlap and create compounding experiences of discrimination. For example, if we go back to our story of Andy Murray and Serena Williams, Williams has experienced discrimination due to her gender, but also horrific racist treatment. Her life in tennis has been far more challenging as a Black woman than it would have been if she were a white woman. When it comes to gender inequality, there is a huge amount of anger in the world. And so there should be. Gender, as it currently functions in society, is a grave injustice for women and for men. Anger, on the other hand, when channeled in the right way, has a long and rich history of affecting positive change. Because when we channel our anger, we can find hope. And this is where you come in, Here is our call to action today. You may well have heard of the hashtag Not All Men. It was problematic for so many reasons, and it doesn't deserve our attention in today's assembly. We know that not all men are sexist, but we also understand that all women have experienced sexism and misogyny in some form, whether at home, at work, in school, on the streets, or online. A better hashtag, and the message to leave you with today, is all men can. Of course, not all men are sexist, but all men can help to end sexism. You can help to end it. As young people, you did not invent the culture of gender inequality in which you find yourselves, but you did inherit it. With that inheritance comes great power and responsibility. In the wake of the Black Lives Matter protests, we learned that it was not enough to be non-racist. We need to be actively anti-racist. In exactly the same way, it is not enough to be non-sexist. We have to be actively anti-sexist. We must all call out sexism and inequality when we see it. Question the status quo. Be an ally in whichever way we can. As a society, and I hope as a school, we have started to redefine masculinity in a way that is more accepting and less about rigid stereotypes. But there is still a long way to go. If we are to truly achieve gender equality, men can help to speed up the process. We hope that today's assembly has opened up a conversation around this important topic. And we want it to be just that, a conversation. Over the coming weeks, you'll have the opportunity to continue to ask questions and to discuss in form time. Today's assembly began with a story, the story of Andy Murray, a fantastic male ally for women in sport. We end it today with a call to action. The fight for gender equality will be won far faster with male allies. As cheesy as it may sound, the future really is in your hands. Use your power and your privilege to be an ally. Join in, support us, be with us. You can be the positive change in the world. All men can. Have a good day.